from Death Cruiser to Douglas Classic. What started out as a proposal for a smaller alternative to the Boeing 747 ultimately became the largest and the last of Douglas's DC series of commercial airliners. Though its basic design remained almost the same throughout its entire production run, the DC-10 underwent significant changes to improve its performance. In today's video, we'll be taking a look at the different variants of the DC-10 and how they differ from one another. The launch version of the DC-10, known as the Series 10, was designed with the aim of providing transcontinental range across the US, based on an American Airlines proposal for a wide body smaller than the 747 and capable of landing in shorter runways. The Series 10 was powered by General Electric CF6 engines, had a max capacity of 380 passengers, and could fly up to 6,500 kilometers. The DC-10 made its maiden flight on August 29, 1970. And entered service with American Airlines and United Airlines a year later in August 1971.
Introducing the new DC-10 luxury liner.
I'm walking on top of the world's newest jet plane, United's DC-10.
Production of the original Series 10 ran from 1970 to 1981, with a total of 131 airframes built. A special sub-variant of the Series 10, known as the Series 15, was equipped with CF6-50C2F engines and designed for use in hot and high airports. Only 7 airframes were built from 1981 to 1983, and they were exclusively used by Aeromexico and Mexicana. During its early years in service, the Series 10 was notorious for being involved in accidents attributed to design flaws. The first of these incidents occurred in 1972, when American Airlines Flight 96 returned to Detroit after the aft cargo door failed and blew out. A similar but fatal accident occurred in 1974, when Turkish Airlines Flight 981 crashed outside of Paris after a cargo door failure, killing 346 people in one of the worst air disasters of the decade. All DC-10s in operation at the time underwent mandatory door modifications as a result of these accidents. The first long-range variant and the most popular model of the DC-10, the Series 30 was designed with larger fuel tanks and a longer wingspan for transoceanic range and improved fuel efficiency, bringing up the DC-10's range to 9,600 kilometers. This increased weight led to the addition of a rear center landing gear for better weight support. Because of its performance, this variant was particularly popular among DC-10 customers outside the US. The model was first delivered to KLM and Swissair on November 21, 1972. With the latter being the first to introduce it into commercial service on December 15th that same year.
50 jaar geleden waren Van der Hoop, Van Weerden Poelman en Van den Broeke ruim 127 uur in de lucht. Nu overbrugt de moderne DC-10 het traject tussen Amsterdam en Jakarta in ongeveer 20 uur.
Sub-variants of the Series 30 included a convertible passenger and cargo version first flown by ONA in 1973, the extended range 30ER, which was introduced by Finnair in 1981 and had an extended range of up to 10,620 kilometers, and the pure freighter Series 30F, which was introduced with FedEx in 1984. A total of 206 were built by the time the last Series 30 was completed in December 1988. The DC-10 Series 40 started life as the DC-10 Series 20. A proposed sub-variant of the Series 10 with extra fuel tanks, 3 feet wingtip extensions, and the rear center gear of the Series 30. At the request of launch customer Northwest Orient, it was powered by Pratt & Whitney JT9D engines for fleet commonality with Northwest's Boeing 747s. It was also redesignated Series 40 so as not to make it appear inferior to the Series 30 that came before it. A total of 42 aircraft were built, with Northwest and Japan Airlines receiving 22 and 20 of them respectively from 1973 to 1979. The Series 40 can be distinguished from other variants externally by a slight bulge at the front of the tail engine nacelle. 10 of Japan Airlines Series 40s were built with a similar gear configuration as the Series 10 for the airline's domestic services, with the long-range center gear and additional fuel tanks being omitted. As the last DC-10s were being delivered, McDonnell Douglas started development on its successor, the MD-11. The MD-11 was designed with a two-crew glass cockpit, in contrast to the DC-10's three-man steam gauge cockpit, which made it challenging for pilots of the DC-10 to transition to the new aircraft. As a result of this, McDonnell Douglas offered glass cockpit upgrades for the DC-10, designated MD-10, starting in 1996. This significantly saved costs for operators of both the DC-10 and MD-11, and allowed common type rating for pilots of both models. Its production run may have had an awkward start with all the design flaws encountered, but the DC-10 remains to be an avgeek favorite and a remnant of a bygone era of widebody jetliners. If you enjoyed this video, please consider leaving a like and subscribing to my channel. Feel free to leave your thoughts and suggestions in the comments section below. Thanks for watching.